Today is really the holy grail of digital marketing. I mean, look at the kind of power you can harness putting together data, technology, and creativity in real time and providing the customer with targeted content, products, and services. In fact, through the entire user journey, you can enhance your customer's experience. McKinsey actually says that personalization leads to 15% increase in revenues, 50% decrease in acquisition cost, and 30% increase in the efficiency of marketing spend. You know, I remember that campaign from 2018 at the Boston Marathon, where Adidas, a front runner in personalization, actually prepared personalized video content for 30,000 runners. Yeah. In fact, Unilever CMO actually goes a step further ahead and says that we're living in this age where I can understand on a one-to-one basis my customer. That's the level of direct engagement that you have at your disposal, ladies and gentlemen. Let's get personal with this next session coming up, the CMO Roundtable. I'm going to invite on stage our session chair, Noor, Group Editor, Marketing and Advertising, BW Businessworld and Digital Market Asia, and she will invite our panel members. Hello!
If you ask me who suffers from FOMO the most, if you ask this room, most people will talk about teenagers. I think marketers suffer FOMO the most. Because often presentation after presentation in meetings like this, the question gets asked in one presentation and the presentation again, are you ready for the future, right? Do you have enough data for the future? The question needs to be reframed, and I'll just come to that, right? This is the classic case of anti-personalization, right? Anybody recognize this? This is the model, Ford Model T. It went against the personalization. It gave huge amount of efficiency in this market. Yet it solved a consumer conflict. Yet it was completely against personalization. And we see many examples. This is not an old example. A lot of us wear clothes which are ready-made, right? That bespoke tailoring has gone beyond a certain niche audience, has gone away. That's anti-personalization that we are seeing all across. Yet it's solving a consumer issue. So the question that we should be always be asking is whether personalization in this context is needed, is it desirable, is it solving a consumer conflict, or we are using the tool just because we've discovered a new tool. So as marketers, we look at two kind of ways we engage with consumers. There's a place where we are talking to consumers where consumer has a fairly sharp focused issue or that they're trying to solve. He's trying to search for, let's say, a milkshake. He's trying to find the nearest plumber, right? That kind of activity, I think digital is fairly good at. And they're very efficient at that. But there's a very large task that we as marketers and brands perform, which is very different, which is frame the problem, own the problem, build auras for our brands, and that's the task where digital possibly magnificently fails, right? And the personalization magnificently fails. I also saw the example of Otrivin in the last presentation, right? I wish I could have put that in my deck, but that's the classical case of stuff that you should be fairly cautious about, right? One of my all-time heroes, Bill Birnbach, right? He talks about that we are in this constant FOMO for looking at what is changing, right? The VUCA world that we talk about. But I think at the very base level, we as consumers, there are some pieces which are very fixed. And there is where the large insight comes from. We might serve people through different new tools that are there, but the basic insight of all of us to be looking good, to be loved, to be admired, to stand out, I think those pieces are, those insights are, I think, fairly static and fairly common. And that's the piece that we shouldn't ever lose sight of in terms of putting our thoughts through, right? So consumers don't care about if I have received in the advertising that I've put together for Otrivin a context about that it's rainy in Mumbai and therefore you should have Otrivin. If I'm able to figure out that this gentleman or this lady needs this problem and I'm able to solve that, I think that's what the consumers care for. The context and sometimes our creations that we fall in love with, I think, is overcomplicating our jobs and possibly falling in love with the two, right? So at times, it's not only about the consumers giving greater amount of choice. It's not necessary at times. The sense of control that consumer is looking for, I think at times that's the key issue that we are doing. I don't know if you guys can see this. It doesn't make Coke taste any different, right? Maybe at the first go, like we talked about, my name is on there, I might pick it up. But we've got to remember consumers, for us, brands play such a large role in our lives because our livelihoods come out of that. Consumers don't care so much about brands, right? And therefore, till the time I think we are solving the key issue and the key insight, I think we are irrelevant. Most times, a lot of us would have seen that this so-called personalized marketing is chasing us, giving us stuff that we've searched and possibly bought, and chasing us about the same thing over and over again. If my task was building consumer affinity at that point of time, I actually have pissed off the consumer, right? At times, we need to know where to draw the line and what is to be done, right? So don't be creepy, because we are largely talking to people. And I think this connection, at times, is not always there. Personalization and relevance is not always there. We've got to step back and remember that we are chasing relevance. And for that, I think the biggest piece is insight. There are times where you've got to step back and you've got to remember that all that the consumer is looking for is you put the entire buffet in front of them and they're smart enough, instead of the AI, ML, and many other acronyms that we talk about, consumer is able to make the choice for themselves, right? The simple pieces, okay? So insight, I think, is, if I could add a few more arrows on this side, is far greater than personalization, right? We are not chasing data, we are chasing insight. And that's the core tool that marketers have. Maybe digital can provide it, we should have that. And I'll share this example of Baby Center. We are a $5 billion company, right? We've grown, we are as brick and mortar and more mortar than anybody gets with Ultratech. We've grown at 60% in the last, I think, 3 years, partly because of inorganic acquisitions. But I think inspiration comes from very different places. So we're not against personalization, but here's a classical example of insight and using data and digital without getting creepy, right? It's, you know, mothers are, families are becoming more and more nuclear, right? And having the first baby, you don't have the support system around you. I can't call the doctor all the time. And yet, I need somebody who can help me at the point of time serving and help me choose what is my stage and what is the issue to be sorted at that point of time. Fairly beautiful, simple insight, right? And used very well without getting creepy, without, quote unquote, tending to be that pseudo personalization, right? We've used this simple example. We took inspiration of this entire thing because what we know in India, there are about 6 million homes that get made. And most Indians, if you may, homemaking is no longer a retirement project in this country, right? It's not 60s project. It's something that you do at the age of 35 today, right? Now, if I do make a home at 35 today, what does that mean? It means that I'm inexperienced. I have a knowledge gap. I have a trust deficit. At the time when I'm making the greatest or biggest project of my life, I'm investing into it. If I have that knowledge gap, what do you do about it? In the old world, we had, I think 10 years ago, we had this huge team of about 1,100 odd people called technical service who would go site to site, help people out, and sort people's issues, right? Because this is a huge badge of competence for somebody who's making their homes, this knowledge is critical. And the cost of going wrong in this entire thing is enormous. So how do you sort that issue out? But the issue is this 1,100 odd strong team, engineers, they still serve about 2.5-3% of India's population of people who are building their first time homes, right? How do you sort that out? Simple stuff. We said we'd give the choice to the consumers and make it easy for them. Choose without getting creepy, we'll help them choose what's the issue that they're defining, define it in fairly simple language. If they are choosing a brick, I tell them three different reasons or three simple steps of how to choose a brick. If they're supervising their home, find out how to supervise that home and the three questions that you need to ask at the end of the day to your contractor, right? Simple experiment that we'd started, I think about 8 to 9 months back. Interesting results. I just want to share, if you could just play this. Could you help me? Playing us. What these are essentially bite-sized, simple in-language videos, simple checklists for people to go and the jobs that they need to be doing in making their entire home. Just go back. Yeah, the video is not playing. Okay. If you could. These are bite-sized videos in languages, about 20 of them, the simplest checklist of FAQs that I have, because I have nobody else to go to. These have touched about 40 million. And I don't have any problems in terms of this being seen in the wrong places, the viewability of this, it being 3-second views or 4-second views, because the consumer is asking for it. As long as you've got the insight right, you are not being creepy, you're co-opting and you're creating value for the consumer. It's been, for us, I think it's transforming, making sure that instead of adding another 1,100 people with our technical service, I'm able to serve far more consumers, and for them, I'm a truly expert brand, right? So I'll leave you with this. Hopefully, we can play the video sometime, but that's fine. That's my message. Thanks.
Thank you, Ajay. Yes, of course, please. Do interesting information, questions for you later. Just one announcement in the meanwhile, there is Knowledge Center research, turn research into money is happening there right now, if anybody is interested in that. Before that, of course, Vishal, I think I'm going to invite him to go up on stage. He is running short on time. Everybody keep your questions ready. After Yash, we'll be taking questions in all. And if that video comes up, we can play it after Vishal's sure. session, yeah?
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Vishal Subharwal, and I head e-commerce and digital marketing at HDFC Life Insurance. Just to give you a bit of a background on HDFC Life Insurance, we are a 20,000 employee strong company with almost 1 trillion rupees of assets under management that we manage. We work with 1 lakh plus agents today. We work with 250 partners, both on the financial side and on the ecosystem side. And we kind of onboard more than 1 million customers every year. And, as I speak to you today, almost, 10% of our customers kind of get onboarded from the e-commerce platform. And pretty much 99% of the customers, come through the digital route, through the assisted route, which our agents kind of help manage. Now, you know, the question that is being asked is personalization a reality or a myth? In my view, the answer is pretty much simple. Personalization is a reality today. Have we become, you know, really, really good at it? You know, I'm not so sure. But when we look at personalization, I think we should not look at it in a purist technology sense. You know, there's a certain human angle to it, the insight angle to it, and, you know, if you were to look at, you know, how some of the good old industries used to operate, so, you know, your Kirana store wala, they would know everything, you know, personalized in the neighborhood in which they would operate. Or if an insurance agent were to visit your home, you know, they would know a little bit about you, the neighborhood in which you stay, your family, the number of children that you had in the home, your parents, you know, your real need, and then they would come out and customize an offering to you. So what we are seeing in the digital age is nothing but an extension of that and how companies are kind of trying to deliver that at scale. You know, a bit of a history of how insurance started. Now, insurance, life insurance as an entity, you know, it's almost multiple centuries old. I mean, if you go back to the Roman Empire, people used to keep a bit of a corpus aside for funeral expenses, right? So if somebody would die in the family and, you know, the entire funeral function used to be a pretty exhaustive affair and you would spend a lot of money. So around 3rd century, 4th century BC, that is when actually insurance actually started, almost 1700 to 1800 years back. You know, the kind of the slightly more modern insurance companies started in Europe. You would have the evangelists, the pastors, you know, traveling over the world. And, you know, you would not know whether they would return home or not. So there was something called as the Scottish widows pool, which was created, wherein, you know, you would know about the people who are part of this pool, right? In some sense, you had enough information, you know, they would belong to this geography or to this sect. And therefore, this set of people would come together and, you know, pool some money, you know, as in terms of manage the risk. And then as the wars, you know, as they call it, the wars between the French and the English Empire started to expand, a lot of the people started traveling, and you would not know whether these young men would come back home and whether the family, you know, whatever, would start to continue its earnings and continue to live a certain lifestyle. That is when insurance started expanding in Europe. So it is, all, in all sense, you know, if you were to look at it, insurance thrives on data points which are very personal in nature. Even today, you know, if you were to apply for a life insurance policy, I need enough information about you. I need, you know, your statistics, for example, height and weight, any medical history that you would have, where you are staying, what is your income. Now, all these are data points that we use to personalize, you know, a premium amount, so as to speak, you know, for an individual. So pretty much insurance to that extent is thrives on data and thrives on personalization. With that, let me just move a bit ahead. So, you know, this pretty much says, you know, it's only marketers collecting some data. So today, anytime you move into any outlet, right, the first thing you ask, they ask you, sir, are you registered with us? Do you have a phone number, right? So they ask you about your phone number and then your name, and then you continuously keep getting messages, you know, of some promotion offer which is running or not. Now, that is the kind of personalization which probably kind of throws out consumers. As Ajay spoke in his previous presentation, it has to be insight-based and it has to be really relevant to the customer at a point of time when the customer wants a certain product or a service. So we have to move beyond, you know, hi Vishal, we have an offer running for you, why don't you come to the store and check it out, or why don't you buy it online? So we have to move beyond that level of personalization and, you know, and therefore insight-driven personalization is what I would call it, Ajay just picking up from what you were saying. And in some sense, you know, what we call personalization today, you know, in the digital world or in the services world, was what somebody in the manufacturing world would call mass customization, right? So the true, if you were to look at the mid-1980s, which is when Dell came up with this offering that you could actually customize the components that you wanted, you know, in a laptop or a desktop that you were purchasing. So that is one example of personalization that was running in an industry almost 30, 35 years back, and the entire Dell model, which is based on personalization and supply chain efficiencies, was based on you know, what we are calling personalization today and, you know, what in manufacturing the Dell guys or the Toyota guys would call as mass customization. Yeah, so pretty much, you know, there's some statistics around this. We have to move beyond high first name. That is what Ajay referred in his presentation. But yes, customers do expect that brands and organizations know enough of their past history. You know, so if I'm pitching to a millennial, you know, who's not bought a basic protection cover for himself or herself, it doesn't make any sense for me to kind of pitch a retirement plan to that particular customer segment or to that particular individual, right? Because it's absolutely mistargeting of information or communication, and that will kind of throw off, you know, that individual away from the brand, and basically I'll go into the spam basket as far as that customer is concerned. So what is personalization at scale? You know, I briefly touched about it in my introductory notes. In insurance, what we need is a lot of data. Now, this was being done by an individual agent or by a pool of people in select geographies. Now, how do you target, you know, a set of people in a population of 1 billion plus, a young demographic coming up, you know, do you set up physical branches in every nook and part of the country? Now, that's going to be very expensive. So the route that we adopt is building this huge chain of ecosystem plays that we have. So, you know, if you were to be an Airtel customer, for example, I can potentially tap into the Airtel database and, you know, bundle an insurance plan for you. If you're walking into a bank branch, I know enough information about you, right? And or the bank knows enough information about you, wherein they can personalize the offering that they have from an insurance company. You don't have to go through the process of giving your personal details again, your contact details. In financial services, KYC is a big thing. So all I need is certain incremental details from you, which are maybe 1/10 of the information that you would typically fill. Now, this works not just in a pure digital unassisted model, but also if you walk into a bank branch, you know, your personal banker would know a reasonably amount of stuff about you to customize a plan. Now, as an insurance company, if I'm offering you 30 products, you know, the person in the bank can't be showing you all 30 products like a supermarket, right? He or she really needs to know your real need, your age profile, and what is the plan that will suit you. So that's how we are using personalization in HDFC Life. And effectively, we're trying to build our own data management platform through this network of ecosystems. And we hope at some point of time this will see you know, become a reality, but you know, there are early signs right now of enough success that we are driving. Why does personalization at scale matter to marketers? I think the answers are quite simple to this. One is, you know, I believe that personalization can drive higher return on the investments that we are making. So the onboarding of the customers can become seamless, the communication can become more relevant. At the same time, you know, you're not kind of doubling down your investments in categories, you know, where you're not getting the right results, right? And using all the automated tools which are available at our disposal today, you know, we can bring down the cost of, you know, marketing to consumers. What we can also do is, let's, you know, kind of talk about an example. Now, you know, you come to my website searching for an insurance plan, but you really don't know you know, what is the quantum of an insurance plan that you should buy? Now, you give me very basic details and I can, you know, work out what we call in insurance parlance, a human life value, right? And then I can customize that offering to you. So for example, you know, I come to the website, I kind of fill in basic details about my age and income. Based on some backend analysis, analytics, and the entire history that we have, I can go back and customize and say, hi, Vishal, I believe that you should buy a term plan which ensures that you have a cover of 1.5 CR, and this will cost you XYZ. Do you need anything more on top of that? And then, you know, as the machines start learning more and more, you know, some of these offerings keep getting customized as more and more customers come on board. So this is something that we are doing even today, and you know, we've seen enough success in the last 12 to 18 months, and this has become, we are becoming better and better at it. The only risk I see is, you know, if you buy some of these marketing technology tools which are sold, you know, by marketers of technology firms, But it's like buying a Ferrari, honestly. You know, you need to ensure, or a Formula One car, you need to have a Schumacher or a Formula One driver available to drive the car. Otherwise, that asset is just going to sit in your garage. So be absolutely sure what you want to do with some of the tools that you are purchasing. So that's one caveat I would put, because there's a whole, they truly benefit you. But if you don't make some of the other investments in people, culture, integrating the technology, creating the back end, deciding the customer ownership policy, as one would call it, because today, does the distributor own the customer? Does the company own the customer? Some of those questions come to light and when we are running an omni-channel or a multi-distribution kind of a company. So some of these basic principles need to be cleared up front. I basically touched upon the right approach of making personalization at work. Repeating it very quickly, make it insight-driven, make it really personal. Don't spam the customer. Yeah, what prevents companies from personalizing at scale? It's largely how you kind of tie in the technology bit. I think the marketing insight bit is available. You can continue doing all the research. The machines can self-learn and throw some of those insights, which Shogato spoke about in his presentation. The technology is available. How do you integrate the human element with the technology and the organization practices, culture? That, in my view, is a potential roadblock. So, if you're planning to deploy any such thing in your organization, please ensure that, some of these things are tied in, which include the resources, the culture, the policies. Because if you don't do that, it's going to be really, really difficult to achieve the ROIs that you had envisaged when you kind of purchase the tools. Yeah, so pretty much summarizing my talk here. It's a core pillar of marketing. I would go beyond marketing. It's a core pillar of what organizations are doing, and we are doing it across the board, not just at the onboarding stage, but also customers need to know their fund value, their premium renewal dates. How do you underwrite a policy? Basically, it's happening across the value chain in our company for life insurance. Pretty much some of the other things that I've spoken about, so I won't repeat them in the interest of time. Pretty much just ensure that whatever you do is customized to a customer, or in our case, we drive personalization to influence what our agents go out and sell in the market. So each industry is different, but I believe personalization is here to stay. There's a gap between what is promised, and by the time you execute it, you have to go through a few roadblocks, and if you can learn from practitioners who've gone through this journey before, it would be a great thing. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. That was awesome. Yash is going up. He's going to take 10 minutes, and then you're all up.
Can I the presentation? Hi, good afternoon. My name is Yeshwanth. I'm the founder of this company called the ThickShake Factory. So we are essentially a food service QSR retailing chain. Very simply put, we sell milkshakes, and we are very good in them. We started about 5 years back. Just a brief background about us. With one store in Hyderabad, today we have about 120 operational, about 35, 40 more in the pipeline. We are present about 25 cities, and we are one of the fastest growing QSR chains in India. And we are proud to say that we are still bootstrapped and haven't raised any VC funding so far, which we pride ourselves on that aspect. So, who are our consumers, right? I mean, for us, 80% of our consumers are millennials. So I'm primarily focusing on this particular TG. So first of all, the human beings, all of us are wired to connect and interact among ourselves, right? So, I mean, right from the Stone Ages when people were talking with sign language and then the language evolved and then people were talking on telephone and telegram and now it's digital communication. So it's the underlying human need to interact with each other. Just that the mediums have been changing and today with the advent of the technology that's existing today, we can communicate and connect to everyone with a click of a phone. So today the scenario is that, man as such has stopped mostly talking in person. We are mostly online. So we are still talking, but maybe we are talking online majorly. Maybe that is the evolvement of the consumers that are there today. I want to take, I wanted to show two examples. Probably here it is too small. The text is too small here. So one company that I wanted to project was Tinder. So what did Tinder do and why has it become most so successful, right? So previously the people, how were relationships formed in earlier, right? So if you see how were they formed, people used to meet and talk. But today the consumers are more comfortable talking online. So what Tinder has done is it has provided a platform for two people to interact online because that is the medium in which today's people are more comfortable interacting. So once you have an initial interaction on Tinder and you don't have so much of time to invest whether you want to like or dislike someone, you just swipe left or right. So for today's generation and for today's instant gratification and decision making ability, this has been the problem. This company has been able to solve that problem. So end of the day, any company or any startup or any company exists for solving a particular problem, whatever is the age. So now coming to the specific topic about personalization, as we all know, there are two types of marketing, inbound and outbound. So how do we personalize inbound and outbound is what I'm going to talk about. So actually, I want to mention this point by Mr. Ajay about how Coke as a product exists. So from the last 100 years, Coke prides itself on saying that we have the same taste since 100 years. So in the food service industry, it's about consistency rather than giving a new product every time. So it's not about personalizing your product at every single point of time, but rather you take pride in saying that the recipe is a 100-year-old recipe or a 400-year-old recipe, right? So in food service industry, it's not about personalizing the product every single time, probably, but it is more about personalizing the brand for your consumer. So that is very important and relevant because if the brand is not personalized to the consumer, the brand will cease to have any relevance. So what we have done here is that we sell our shakes in a glass, right? So initially when we started out, we wanted our consumers to think that whenever they see a glass, they think about our brand. So hence we designed our logo in this way. And also the word ThickShake is a generic name. But when we started about 5 years back, nobody were selling only ThickShakes, the specialty retailing. So we named also the brand ThickShake Factory in the hope that when people think about a ThickShake, they should think about the ThickShake Factory, and it's been working out that way. So what is more personal than a festival, right? I mean, how do we remain relevant to our consumers and how do we attract consumers? So we do this kind of campaigns where for every specific festival, we come up with a specific creative and run the campaign. So if you see different types of faiths, but we always, we actually personify our logo. That's our typical campaign. We personify our logo and make it like a hero and in play with it in the background. So that's how we have been doing it. And again, if you come back to the seasonal variants, there are seasonal personalization. So one is the, when it's a summer, you personalize for the, the seasonal varieties that are available and so on. Like a Christmas season and for the summer season, you come up with the mangoes. So it's not about personalizing the product every single time. But what I'm trying to say is that for every different occasion, you have to be personalizing your brand. Like, so what we say is that there is a ThickShake for every moment. So that's our focus. So for every happy moment in your life or for every sad moment in your life, if you're frustrated with your boss or with your job or your life, you have a ThickShake and it makes you feel good. If you are happy and you're elated, you want to celebrate, you have a ThickShake. And if you are feeling moody, you know, to lift up your mood, you have a thick shake. You know, you want to have a write an exam or you have an interview tomorrow to burst your stress, you have a thick shake. So it's about personalizing every single moment in a consumer's life so that the consumer is always related to you. That's how we are trying to build the brand. And so far, it's been working well for us. So if you see some specific campaigns like No Shave November, right? So we have we had done this campaign which worked very well for us on Instagram and on Facebook. We personified our logo itself into a man with a beard, and we said we are shaving off 15% off. So a lot of bearded men started coming to our outlets and you know, doing this. So I mean, we had no idea that who's having a beard like me at this point of time. So we can't target these people online. But when we run these campaigns at a specific TG across online mediums, thankfully we are able to do that kind of targeting. So this kind of campaigns are really working well for us. And even if you see, like recently when for the India-Pakistan match, so it's about, we said, you know, you celebrate this, you're watching the match, you order this. So we ran a campaign on Swiggy and we got a very huge response. I mean, I'm talking about 250% sale increase within a week because of a single campaign that we did. So again, I'm coming back to some specific campaigns. Like, so basically when today's consumers are also very passionate about causes. They don't care about the product only. So once the product is available widely and it becomes a commodity, it's about what causes the brand is related to, and only when the brand is associated with some good causes of in the minds of the consumer, only then they will actually follow the brand. So we have to be relevant to the changing trends and times. A classic example is, of course, the Amul classic marketing campaign. Whatever the event or occasion is there, you know, they come up with something brilliant. So right from our inception, we have been inspired by Amul, and we try to associate an event or a trend with our brand so that it remains relevant in our consumer's mind. So these are some of the campaigns that we did for an International Women's Day and AIDS Day and so on. Actually, these are videos, but unfortunately, I don't know, the videos are not playing. So this is what I wanted to convey by saying that, you know, you have to suit every specific occasion to our product, and that's how we have been doing this. Our store is also pretty personalized by what I say, by which I mean that every city that we go to, we have a separate wall dedicated to that particular city alone. So this is a creative that is there for Kolkata, and this is another city for in Bombay, and so on. And one last thing that I wanted to say was, with the advent of aggregators like Swiggy and Zomato with $2-3 billion of funding coming to them, today the mostly food service is about delivery and takeaway, which is increasing rapidly. So we have a lot of data that we can work out with. Like, for example, we have access to data like when you search in a particular geography for a certain product, and if that product is there, not there, like for example, in you're sitting in Bandra and you're searching for a thick shake, but there is no outlets giving you thick shakes, then we will get to know that there is a demand for this, that the consumers are searching. So based on this is called demand shaping. So based on this, we are actually locating our outlets because we have you know, a lot of data. So this has been really driving the industry, and you're more or less sure shot about the sales. So the data is really helping us and the entire industry. Thank you so much for the opportunity to speak in front of you. Thank you.
Yeah, he really rushed through that. Thank you. Questions? Who has question? You get to ask one question because we're extremely short on time. How many of you are dying to ask about this whole personalization versus privacy? Yeah, so you know what? We'll just ask it on your behalf, which is everybody is... Yeah, so I'm doing the thing of... Yeah, we kind of... Everybody's talking about how personalization happens at the cost of privacy. And that's a big challenge that marketers are navigating through. That opt-in is one audience, but that other audience, especially because of that spam that we have started as a culture, has opted out. How do you deal around that to actually get to personalization at scale?
So maybe I'll recraft the question. Privacy is like he talked about. The neighborhood banya was always there, right? He knew about you. He knew about your father, your kids, yeah. And we never minded that privacy invasion. The question where consumers get irritated, where A, all of us have received HR letters with our name framed being there and very personalized letter, right? This is the great achievement you've done for the last year and it's digitally signed, etc. When you fake personalization and don't add value with that entire thing, I think consumer is asking the question as to why did I let you in and what did you do with this? You obviously misused a privilege. Yet, if you are creating value, I think consumers are absolutely fine.
But that line of creepy that you mentioned,
yeah,
when it is not insights driven, both of you have spoken about that, which is bad personalization. When that happens, and that happens a lot, so how do you then, you know, circumvent or navigate that?
My question, just one small piece. I think we are too much, and which is why I said this FOMO of we've found this new tool and we've got to somehow use it. I think the refrain that we need to as marketers have, if I don't have a good use of it, it's fine telling the consumer, right, dealing with the consumer in a normal fashion. If you don't have use for his information, it's absolutely fine not filling a 20-page questionnaire with the consumer. This is the information we do not need of you. So I think you've got to put some self-restraint into yourself.
Vishal, you want to add to that?
Yeah, I mean, my experience has been that customers are willing to give you more information if you're willing to give them a promise of better service or delivery.
I'm one of those customers,
yeah,
for
so
sure.
There's a huge market for that. You know, even the Aadhaar debate which happened, which was largely oriented around privacy, I think that was more to do with big government and, you know, how government would use that data to, you know, survey customers. But as far as individual institutions are concerned, I don't think consumers had a fear about that. So, you know, 9 out of 10 customers definitely were willing to give their Aadhaar card and information for a more convenient onboarding or a service promise.
Thank you. Thank you. Yash, I'm sorry, I cannot let you answer because we really are very short on time. Just to summarize this whole thing, of course, personalization is a reality. Personalization at scale is work in progress from what we have understood. What it gives us is lots of benefits. It will generate revenue. It will give you brand loyalty. It will give you improved user experience for your consumers. It will create a longevity towards your brand. However, it cannot be, and I'm going to now steal words from these gentlemen, it cannot be creepy. It has to be, it cannot be, what was this, irrelevant. And it also cannot be something that, you know, it's not cutting down on your wastage of marketing budget, which means it has to be data. It cannot be data before insights. It has to be insights driven. It has to be good personalization. Hence, individualized experience of your consumer gets better. I'm hoping to God that we have answered the question that we started with. But a loud round of applause for my panelists. They were awesome. And for yourselves, I think we were before lunch. We'll let them go now.
And Noor, you have one more job to do. Please present our panelists with mementos, token of our appreciation. Thank you all. Thank you, really. Please stay with us on stage. This is our way of saying thank you to you for taking out the time and joining us at Tech Munch 2019. Thank you. I didn't know there was like a tax on claps and applause and all that. Is there? I don't know. Oh, there isn't. Thank you. And please come together for a group photograph.